Welcome to the Episcopal Church's in Lowell service of Holy Communion this day. We are coming to you from St. Anne's Church, and we are glad that you can be with us today. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us pray. The Collect for the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. O God, you declare your almighty power chiefly in showing mercy and pity. Grant us the fullness of your grace, that we, running to obtain your promises, may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages, as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The word of the Lord. Hear my teaching, O my people. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will declare the mysteries of ancient times. that which we have heard and known and what our forefathers have told us, we will not hide from their children. We will recount to generations to come the praiseworthy deeds and the power of the Lord and the wonderful works he has done. He worked marvels in the sight of their forefathers, in the land of Egypt, in the field of Zoan. He split open the sea and let them pass through. He made the waters stand up like walls. He led them with a cloud day by day, and all the night through with a glow of fire. He split the hard rocks in the wilderness and gave them drink as from the great deep. He brought streams out of the cliff, and the waters gushed out like rivers. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Philippians. If there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, for it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him as he was teaching and said, "By what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority?" Jesus said to them, "I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin?" And they argue with one another. If we say from heaven, he would say to us, "Why then did you not believe him?" But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regard John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, "We do not know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' He answered, 'I will not.' But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same. And he answered, 'I go, sir, But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believe him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. The gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. We live in a society in which authority is very important. In democratic societies, the source of authority is the people, the constitution, and the laws. And in Jesus' day, religious authority was very important. This passage of Matthew comes just after Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. And shortly after his entry into the city, he went to the temple and cleansed the temple of money changers and merchants, and told these people that they had converted his father's house into a den of thieves. And he even whipped a few of these people. So the religious authority wanted to know, where did Jesus get his authority to do the things he did and say the things he said? What's the source of your authority? They must have said, you didn't go to seminary. We never saw you in any of our rabbinic schools. So where did you get your authority to come into our house and disrupt our religious practices? You see, Jesus did not only disrupt their religious practices, but he also disrupted their business. Because those who came to the temple to offer sacrifice to God had to offer an unblemished animal. And if you brought your own little animal for sacrifice, the temple inspector had to certify that the animal was unblemished. And in most cases, you wouldn't get the approval. So you would have to purchase an unblemished animal from the temple vendors for a markup price. But that was not all. You could not use the ordinary or Roman currency to make your offering to the temple. So you had to exchange your currency for temple currency at an unfavorable exchange rate. So the temple authority were rightfully upset that this man, Jesus, would come into their temple and upset the apple cart. Needless to say, they were not happy. They had a good thing going, and Jesus just ruined it. They were running a very lucrative business in the temple, and this itinerant preacher just came in and ruined the whole thing. So they decided to confront Jesus and challenge his authority. Jesus refused to answer the question directly, because as one biblical commentator said, if Jesus had said God had sent me, then they could justify a blasphemy charge against him. And Jesus senses that a straight answer would precipitate his death before he had finished his work on earth. If he claimed human authority just from himself, he would lose popular support from the people. And in this way, the religious authority could negate his message and ultimately much more easily have him executed without the fear of an uprising from the people. So Jesus followed a great rabbinic tradition of answering the question by asking a question in return. And as Matthew tells us, that question caused the Pharisees a great problem. If they answered that John's authority came from God, Jesus would follow that up by saying, then why didn't you listen to him? If they said his authority was simply human, they feared a backlash from the people who recognized John as a prophet. Jesus might not had any official authority, but he did have one authority that the religious leaders did not, namely the authority and power of God. So when we as Christians say that we acknowledge the authority of Jesus because it is from God, then we must obey his words and follow his example. Whenever we confront injustice in our world, whenever we demand equality for everyone, equal justice for everyone, we can say that our authority to say these things come from Jesus, because we are his followers. But we need to be careful how we live our lives as Christians. We just can't pay lip service to God. We just can't proclaim to be Christians but don't live like Christians. And that is why Jesus used the parable of the two sons to tell the religious leaders that the folks on the bottom end of society, the prostitutes, the tax collectors, may have said no to God in the past, but they said yes now. It was not too late. Because on the other hand, the religious authority once said yes to God, but never let God into their lives. In other words, those who live their faith have a better chance in God's kingdom than those who only profess their faith. I am a Christian, but don't live a Christian life. Like the old saying, actions speak louder than words. And this reminds me of a story that I may have told you before. It's the story about a good law-abiding lady who was driving one day down the road while she was tailgated by a stressed-out gentleman. Suddenly, they reached a traffic light just as it turned yellow. The law-abiding lady did the right thing, stopping at the crosswalk, even though she could have beat the yellow light. Now the tailgating man hit the brakes, honked his horn, lowered his window, and began to scream in frustration as he missed his chance to go through the light. He cursed the woman, flipped his fingers at her, and in the middle of his rant, he heard a tap on his window and looked up to see a police officer ordering him to follow the police cruiser to the nearest police station. Now the man began to complain, "I did nothing wrong, why should I follow you?" But the police insisted that he should follow him to the station. Once they got to the station, the police officer locked him up in a holding cell. After about an hour, the officer came, opened the holding cell, and said to him, "I'm sorry I arrested you. You're free to go." So the gentleman, still very furious, said to the officer, "What did I do wrong? Why did you arrest me?" The officer said, "While you were in the middle of your rant, cursing off the woman, I noticed your bumper sticker that said, 'Choose life.' What would Jesus do?" Another sticker said, "Follow me to church." And naturally, I assume you had stolen the car. The poor guy left the police station with his head down. So you see, it is more important how we live our faith than how we talk about our faith. Amen.
The prayers of the people today will follow the form 2 from the prayer book with variation. I ask your prayers for God's people throughout the world, for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, Presiding Bishop of the Episcopal Church, for Alan and Gail, our bishops, for Douglas, Bishop of Western Massachusetts, for our Rector Ennis, and for our assisting priests, Anne, Richard, and Sarah, for this gathering and for all ministers and people. Pray for the church. I ask your prayers for peace, for goodwill among nations, and for the well-being of all people. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for the poor, the sick, especially those struggling with the effects of COVID-19, the hungry, the homeless, the fearful, the oppressed, all refugees and those in prison. Pray for those in any need or trouble. I ask your prayers for all who seek God or a deeper knowledge of God. Pray that they may find and be found by God. I ask your prayers for the departed, for all who have died by violence, and for everyone who has died as a result of the current pandemic. Pray for those who have died. I ask your prayers for strength, compassion, and skill for all healthcare workers at every level, and for comfort for the friends and families of those afflicted by this pandemic. I ask your prayers for everyone working to develop treatments and vaccines to heal and prevent the spread of COVID-19. I ask your prayers for all who are trying to follow safe practices to protect themselves and others from contagion. I ask your prayers for schools and teachers and children who are trying to find safe ways to continue the education of our children and young adults. Pray for an end to this pandemic. I ask your thanksgivings for everyone who continues to do the many jobs that undergird our day-to-day lives. I ask your thanksgivings for all who reach out to others in love, seeking forgiveness and reconciliation. I ask your thanksgivings for the beauty of God's world around us. I ask your thanksgivings for the generosity, encouragement, and love and hope we experience and share each day. Praise God for those in every generation in whom Christ has been honored, remembering those whose lives have influenced our own lives for good. Pray that we may have grace to glorify Christ in our own day. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give God thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us your peace. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. We pray together a prayer of spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Blessed Sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come spiritually into my heart, that I may live in you and you in me, in this life and the life to come. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you forever. Amen.